World War II spotlight, basically. Well, it's the back of it. It's an amazing thing, isn't it?
Yeah.
I'd love to be able to show you the other side. But I can't.
It's a beast, isn't it?
It is a beast of a thing. I'd love to fire it up properly, just thinking about it. Take it somewhere and just quickly turn it on. Imagine, it'd be like the bat signal going off, wouldn't it?
This huge searchlight dates from the Second World War and was designed to illuminate enemy aircraft attacks at night. It had a very bright carbon arc lamp backed by a mirrored parabolic reflector, which projected a powerful beam that would have been able to swivel and tilt.
The thing is, you know, in terms of an actual sort of fabrication point of view, the hardest thing to make on one of these is this bit.
Yeah.
Which, of course, we've got. So, you know, let's not beat about the bush. This is an absolutely mammoth task, and it's an awful amount of work. But you've got the difficult bit.
So I'm thinking outside, garden, massive country house.
Lighting, building, trees.
All that sort of stuff, you know, something like that. What I'd like to be able to do with it is obviously have it stood up.
Yep.
And then have a base. It needs to swivel all the way around, and it needs to tilt.
Not a problem. I mean, it's...
I love your optimism.
So we got the light such as it is, the glass in the middle, like that. And it's going to need to sit on a big cradle. And then, so we need to have it on a square base. Yeah, I think we'll go with that. Right, so we got this nice substantial piece of box, and this is going to form the base framework that everything else is then going to be built off of. We're just going to make a very basic square. The most important thing is that it's fit for purpose, that it's strong enough that it can take the weight. Also, that it's not going to topple over. You know, we're going to be talking something that's probably going to be pushing a ton by the time it's finished.
With the base built, Ted begins to construct the first of the two cradle arms to go on top. But before committing to a weld, he wants to see if his idea makes sense.
What I'm going to do, I'm going to lay out the first kind of section on the floor, purely because it's the size of it. It's all very, very two-dimensional at the moment. As it builds up, it will take its 3D form. And once we've got one, then the second one will come a lot easier.
He's a man with a plan, but there's a long way to go to make this extraordinary wartime relic work again. In Dorset, metalworker Ted is going great guns with the restoration of a World War II searchlight. Although he's found moving any part of it is a challenge.
Now, the thing with the back of this is it's incredibly heavy.
He's about to start work on the light mechanism, but hasn't yet checked out the reflector.
If it's in a poor state, then we're going to have a real issue with this because it's going to suddenly create an awful lot of extra work.
British searchlights had reflectors made of mirrored glass, a fragile material which is all too easily broken.
Oh, wow. That's in really good condition. Considering this thing's 80-plus years old, that is amazing.
The curved mirror reflected the light from a powerful electromechanical arc light, which is rusted and broken, but not missing.
It's an amazing thing. I'm really quite smitten with this. The way these things used to work is they had a carbon arc. So you had a rod of carbon, which we still have on here, and then it would strike an electrical arc and gradually the carbon would burn down. Now, the light was so bright that it could illuminate planes miles and miles and miles up in the air. If we were able to get this to the same level of brightness that it was in the 1940s, we would be burning our retinas out, completely over the top.
Ted's big challenge is to make the searchlight light up dramatically, but in a way that can be used safely by anyone.
I have a holder. So this is from a spotlight from a theatre, and I've got a 650-watt halogen bulb. What I'm going to do is I'm going to make a little bracket for the holder to put it in the same area that the carbon light would have been to accept our theatre light bulb.
The original carbon arc light was as hot and bright as this welding light and too dangerous to use. But Ted needs to put the new light source in the same position so the mirrored reflector can work to full effect. To do this, he's made a simple T-shaped steel bracket, which he welds onto the old mechanism.
Yeah, that's good. It's way stronger than it ever needs to be. So that's all on, that's all tight. What we need to do now is get some power to it. Little terminal block. Just want to make sure that everything is working at the moment. And there's also that little bit of glory, just to see what it's like with a light on the inside of it. Like everything else on this light, nothing is easy going. It all weighs an absolute lump. It's great. When the glass is on, you're going to look in and you're going to see this. You're going to see it all.
Ted must take care. He can't touch the quartz with his bare hands, as any grease can weaken the bulb and cause the lamp to explode during operation.
It's in.
He also turns the searchlight away to protect his eyes when the 650-watt bulb powers up.
Moment of truth. It's quite bright. Look at that. Oh, man, this is going to be spectacular.
Metalworker Ted has forged ahead with the searchlight. Having completed his constructions for the new body, he's now seeing if it all works.
Now that it's on there, and the turntable with all of the bearings in there, and it is so smooth, I mean, that is just as good as I could have hoped for.
But the searchlight is a completely different beast from the one Drew last saw. Ted's about to find out if all his effort has paid off.
Hey, Ted.
Drew.
How you doing?
Wow.
Look at that. It's amazing. It's an incredible thing.
It's a beast, isn't it?
It is. Talk me through it.
Because we had the glass, I had the diameter, I had the circumference, I had a good starting point, so I knew how big the thing had to be. But then I started at the bottom and just worked up.
So does it turn?
Yes, it does. It does turn.
Hey, that's good, isn't it?
Yeah.
Wow.
Yeah,
that's really good.
That came out really, really well.
When Ted first saw this light, it came in a crate, and most of it was missing. The huge parabolic mirror was intact, but the arc light was broken, and all means of mounting and using the light lost.
Well, can we turn it on?
We can turn it on.
Now it's a working searchlight once more.
That's great.
Incredible. Amazing.
Ted has fitted a lower power bulb to the original light, making it usable in a domestic setting, such as a garden. He's built a frame in keeping with his military past. It's able to swivel and tilt just as it would have done back in its day. And to complete the authentic look, it's been painted in army green.
We've saved a piece of wartime history,
yeah.
Potentially a piece of very interesting bit of our national culture that we do need to save every part of that. So thanks, Ted.
Is that it? Can I
yeah,
go now?
You can go now. Leave it with us.
Don't ever buy another one, will you?
Thanks, Ted. Cheers.
Bye-bye.
Turned really well.
Not quite sure that Drew knew what he was going to be in for, because the last time he saw it, we just had the back, nothing else. And he looked pretty gobsmacked when he saw it, because it's a beast.
It's really big. And then he goes, well, actually, it's just on a plug now. And I think that's the most surprising thing about it. It's just on a household 3-pin plug. You just stick it in the wall. Bam, you've got, you know, this amazing, incredible searchlight. Ted has put in countless hours, back-breaking work. So hats off to him. Another one saved.